The special thing about a thermal battery, as opposed to a regular electrochemical battery or other kind of energy storage, is that you have to appreciate that the entire world runs on heat. If you think about electricity, where it comes from today, more than 90% of it comes from heat. We're burning fossil fuels, we're running nuclear power plants, all of those are just heat sources just to run and run a heat engine to convert it to electricity. Same is true for transportation. You go out to your car, you've got an internal combustion engine. The purpose of burning the fuel is to make heat so you can run the engine. So heat at its core is what we run on. The majority of thermal fluid systems that are built are going to be built out of steel, nickel alloys, some kind of metal. There's very good reasons why we do that. But the issue is that those materials are kind of fundamentally limited, meaning physics is just set for the way that those atoms are bonded. We are now known for is demonstrating the ability to pump liquid metal at extreme temperatures, make systems out of materials like ceramics and graphite. And where the impetus to even try those materials in that way came from was really atomic level insight, because we had this ceiling of about 1,000 degrees Celsius. We can't really go far beyond that. And so I started trying to remove the constraints, put a system in an inert environment rather than in air. You just took away oxygen, one of those most reactive elements on the periodic table. Virtually every atom on the periodic table will form some kind of oxide. They'll all react with oxygen. So if you take oxygen out of the equation, now you have the option to use all kinds of materials that were not possible in air at high temperature. If you're going to try to go extremely hot, then don't rely on metallic bonding. The stiffest, strongest bonds in nature are covalent bonds. So why not switch to covalent bonds? And covalent materials like ceramics and graphite, covalently bonded materials that are very refractory. The first big breakthrough we had was we did actually figure out how to join pipes made out of graphite and ceramics in a way that would not leak liquid metal. And so we started using metal as actually the fluid that we were moving around instead of the solid infrastructure. We had another breakthrough that technology involves thermal photovoltaics, where you convert heat back to electricity using photovoltaics, or like a solar cell, in the sunniest and the windiest places on Earth. Solar and wind electricity is actually cost competitive directly with fossil fuels, and in many cases, it's actually cheaper. But this is based on what we call a levelized cost of electricity basis, meaning if you just take all the cost that you put in to build that entire power plant, either wind or solar, divide that by the total amount of electricity that would come out of it over its entire lifetime, that ratio can actually be smaller than fossil fuels. That's great. The problem is you don't get that electricity when you want it. And so the way the grid operates is it's direct supply to demand. And that now necessitates putting in some kind of storage. The problem is, if you look at the storage technologies that exist today, they're all way too expensive. So if you add storage to solar panels, it turns out the battery is more expensive than solar panels are. So you've now blown away all the cost advantages of going solar. The key insight here is that I know that storing heat can actually be 10 to 100 times cheaper than storing it electrochemically. So that's an insight from the atomic level that then led us down this path to say, well, let's make a system that stores heat at extremely high temperatures so we can convert it efficiently and get the cost down. You think about a battery, there are two parts to it. There is how much energy it can store, and then there's also the rate at which you can charge and discharge it. Both of those are important. The other technologies that are trying to get to similarly low costs as us are limited when it comes to how fast you can charge and discharge it. And what is a beautiful advantage for us, and this ultimately comes from the liquid metal, the high temperature infrastructure, all of that, is that we are not limited in that way. So right now, utilities are not interested in buying or putting up batteries that have a duration of discharge longer than about 4 to 6 hours. The reason is that they simply don't need it. And what we expect is that over time, over the next decade or two, that's eventually going to extend, and they'll eventually want like 10-hour batteries. And eventually, it's been predicted we'll even get to 100-hour batteries. And so what's special about having a thermal battery, we can make a 5-hour battery, a 10-hour battery, 50, 100, anything in between that we want. On the one hand, our battery can take in electricity, store it, and then put back out electricity. That's its primary usage. That's where we expect the biggest impact to be. But it has other features as well. It can also take in electricity and output heat. And the reason that's special is because our heat is stored at an extremely high temperature, so we can supply any industrial processes needs. So it gives us a higher efficiency, lower cost, other things if we don't have to do the extra conversion back to electricity. It can also serve like a normal power plant. we can take in fuel and put out electricity. So in the sense that we can do all three of those, we have a very complete solution for the grid. We can serve as a regular battery, we can supply industrial processes, and when the grid goes down, or whenever all the batteries are fully discharged, we have the ability to back it all up by taking in fuel and keeping the grid going. This will ultimately allow renewable electricity to be used anytime you want it, not just when the sun is out and the wind is blowing.